Dawkins.
Good morning. Matthew 14:33. David said in Psalms 122:1, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Anybody else happy to be here? Matthew 14:33, then those disciples who were with Jesus worshipped him and saying, truly you are the Son of God. It is Father's Day. It is the day we get to come back to church in full mass and four-part harmony. But those are all the extras. The reason that we're here in the sanctuary is to worship Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Just like the disciples. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us and call us your children. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you have opened the doors and invited your children to come and worship you. And so, Heavenly Father, let us lift up your name. Let us praise the name of Jesus in our songs, in our prayers, and in our sermon. Let us do it in the power of the Holy Spirit, and we will be so bold as to tell you, thank you in advance. For we ask these things in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Seated. Been so long since we had such good singers up there, they didn't want to leave the stage. we're going to do the responsive reading. And I'll say the first stanza, and then if you could repeat the second stanza, there's no better way to get closer to Jesus than His holy word. Amen?
Amen.
And so let's say it like we mean it. He was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquity. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him, and by His wounds we are healed. All light, my sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and give his life as a ransom for many. We are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Christ died for sins once for all, so that he might bring us to God. May God add his blessing upon the reading of his holy word. Fathers are large people who frequently declare that other children eat their meal and sit straight in their chair. Other children wash their hands according to my father. They never yell or lose their hats or fight or be a bother. Other children, father says, speak when they're spoken to. They answer please and thank you the way I'm supposed to do. I feel sorry for my father, as sorry as I can be. He knows such lovely children and gets stuck with one like me. Happy Father's Day. Happy first day of summer. Better watch out. It's going to start to get hot now. Okay? But we want to welcome you to Lincoln Community Church. And whether you're in the sanctuary, whether you're joining us online in your office or in your living room, we know that when we come together, we are better than we could ever be alone. And when you join us, it makes us better. Today, we have a couple of anniversaries we want to remember. Dick and Maria Basinger have provided the altar flowers for us today, and they'll be celebrating their 13th wedding anniversary this week. Marcia and Arvid Johnson are celebrating 55 years of marriage this week. And Judy and Marvin Hilger are celebrating their 54th wedding anniversary this week. And so as a congregation, as a church, we want to wish these couples, may they live as long as they like. And may they like each other as long as they live. But God bless you on this week. We have a number of announcements. If you have that bulletin, you're going to have to read it through three times just to get all of the information. So let me share a couple of things with you. As we are just turning the corner, getting some sort of semblance of coming back to normal, you're going to find those attendance books on your aisle. And if you could write your name down, and that way we have a record of your attendance. We're also going to start taking an offering as part of our worship service, and our ushers will come to you. Not only is tithing an act of worship, it's the action of the heart of the Christian. By the way, we could use some more ushers. And if you're willing to be an usher a couple weeks a month, that would help us out. And so with those yellow slips that you have in your bulletin, that is a wonderful way to communicate with our staff, with our pastors. Any information that you have that you want us to know, please let us know. Our food drive starts today. We're going to put out the table on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So all you have to do is drive up to the front, drop off your food, and then drive away. Our food drive is going to Salt Mine, who provides food for our community. Also in your bulletin, you're going to find that long list of names. It is that list of names that we will get our name badges from. And so please check that list over. If your name is there and everything is fine, you don't have to contact us. But if we've done something, if we spelled it wrong, if you don't want Thomas and you want Tom, let us know. And we can adjust that as well. And also in our prayer, there are those family members of this church that need to be prayed for. And we want to keep them before the throne of God. We want to remember Bob and Norma Rafigi, Bill Anderson, Bill and Jan Gordon, Roy Devers, and Bill Scott. But we would be the weakest of all Christians if we didn't say thank you to God when he answered our prayer. 2 weeks ago, Joy Acoin had two back surgeries in 3 days. And she's back home. And she's starting to heal. And so not only will we ask God to pray for these members, we will tell God, thank you. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you've brought this unique group of people into Lincoln Hills Community Church. And Father, we would pray for the people. We would pray for our congregation that you would join us together through your Spirit. Heavenly Father, let us rejoice in the fact that we've come together as the family of God. And those who are named in our prayer list, Lord, we know it's not just the physical demands that they're suffering, but it's the mental and emotional. It's the spiritual things. And so, Father, we pray that your Spirit would fall upon them and their families. Be gracious to them. We would tell you thank you for our volunteers, our singers, our musicians, our elders, our ushers, our security. There are so many who give of their time and their talent. Father God, bless them. We would ask that you would bless our offering today as we continue to be a lighthouse to the community in Lincoln. Bless the gift and the giver. And Father, while we're still holding your hand, we would pray that you would grant our requests for the glory of your name as we recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
God sent his Son, they called him. Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face a certain day, because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross a river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Thank you.
Oh man, isn't it great to be back?
Amen.
Now I don't have to guess who you are with the mask on, you know? This has been an interesting year, you know, when you don't see anybody for a year, and then when I finally see you, you've got a mask on, and not everybody's wearing name tags. Oh, wow, you know, it taxes my memory. So good to see you all this morning, seeing the smiles on your face. Let me tell you a couple things that are coming up. 4th of July, which is 2 weeks away, we hope you can all come. We're going to have a barbecue. And if you've been here for our guys that put the barbecue on, you know it is terrific. We're going to have a great time of fellowship, and it'll be right after the service on the 4th. And we hope you can be here with us. 2 days before that, on Friday night, which is to be kind of the beginning of the whole weekend, Friday night, we will be having a concert here. And there's a little thing in there that tells you a little bit about it. Our own Jim here on the organ, and Jim Martinez on the piano, and Catherine Skinner singing. It's going to be a great evening, patriotic concert. We hope you can come. It starts at 4 p.m. Going to be fun to have you. What a wonderful weekend, and we look forward to that. 2 weeks away, so we'll keep reminding you. Put it on your calendar. Hope you can be with us. One other item I want to mention too, The week after 4th of July, on the 11th of July, we will be having, following our service, another one of our welcome seminars. If you've been coming here and you'd like to know more about what makes us tick, or you like what's here and you think you'd really like to unite with us and become part of this place, or you just want a free meal, we do give you a free meal. We meet after the church service. Pastor Jody and I do the seminar. We help let you get a little idea who we are, tell you a little bit about us and our wives, and because we get to hear a little bit about you. But then we go through about what we believe here and kind of how we operate. It takes maybe an hour and a half, something like that. But we just have a great time around the table. We hope you can come. If you want to come, let us know. You probably already put the yellow slip in the offering thing, but next week, write it down. I want to come to the welcome seminar. That way, we will put a shrimp on the Barbie for you. No, we won't put a shrimp on the Barbie, but we will get a sandwich for you. Anyway, hope you can come. Going to get back into this series I started with. Everybody wants to know about prophecy. And so, you know, they want to know whether or not the vaccination is the mark of the beast. They want to know who the Antichrist is. They want to know when the rapture is and so on and so forth. And we are going to get into some of that stuff. But the first couple of weeks, I've really been wanting to lay a little groundwork for you, because when you talk about prophecy, what is prophecy about? It's not just a predictive issue. It's a declarative issue. It's all about the fact that Jesus Christ is coming back. That's what we look forward to. Amen? Don't you? Yeah. I always tell people, I remember as a kid when I was in junior high, baseball was everything to me. And it was when they were putting the Berlin Wall up. You remember that? Some of you can still remember that anyway. And I thought the world was coming to an end. I thought Jesus was coming. But you know what my prayer was? Lord, not until the end of summer when Little League is over. Don't laugh. Some of you have prayed a similar prayer. It just wasn't about Little League. Yeah, okay. But prophecy, we do look forward to that. But what prophecy is really about is what a preacher by the name of W.A. Criswell, he was a great preacher at the First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas, preached a sermon one New Year's Eve. And it was called The Scarlet Thread of Redemption. And actually, there's a book now. He published a book on it. But it's all about how prophecy begins a biblical journey to redemption from Genesis to Revelation. And I want to look at that with you today. Because when you and I start talking about prophecy, we need to understand that what it's really about, above all else, is about God's journey to redeem a fallen creation, to redeem you and me, and not just you and me, but the whole earth, the whole heavens and the earth. I said last week, what's the Bible begin with? First verse, what is it? In the beginning, what? God created the heavens and the earth. When you get to the end of the book, to the book of Revelation, what does John see? Behold, there was a new heaven and new earth. And we talked about that last week. The journey is all about what God was doing in prophecy to lay all the groundwork, the promises that were made in prophecy to you and to me. And that's what I want to talk to you about this morning. Six promises we're going to talk about here. And you go, oh my, this is going to be a long sermon. No, I'm going to try to move kind of quickly, okay? But I'm a little pumped, so I can't guarantee you what time you get out of here, but that's okay. Just seeing you all smile and just here just gets the energy going. But okay, here we go. We're going to talk about there's a promise of a Savior. There's a promise of a solution. A promise of a sacrifice. A promise of a surrender. And a promise of salvation. And lastly, a promise of security. So let's look at these. This is the scarlet thread of redemption, if you will. These are the promises that prophecy makes to us. It's what the whole Bible is about. So let's look at it. Let's talk about a Savior, first of all. First thing it says, Genesis 3:15. I've said this to you many times before. If you didn't get it today. It's the first place in the Bible that the gospel is preached. Now, years ago, when I was just a young guy, about 21, 22, and I was getting the Bible, and somebody told me that, and I said, where in the world? What? But then they began to explain to me. This is God's word. He speaks to Satan in the fall when Adam and Eve had sinned, and he says to Satan, I'm going to put enmity, means hostility, between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. You will strike him in the heel and he will crush your head. And of course, we talked about that last week. It's a prediction of the cross. And when you go back to the very ancient rabbis, they interpreted this as referring to the Messiah. But the key words here are seed. Well, keep that in mind. Well, in your seed, if you'll remember, we go a little further ahead and you come to Abraham. Remember Abraham? And God said to Abraham, I'm going to make you a great nation, and in your seed will all the nations of the earth be blessed. There it is, that word seed again. Now, when you come to 2 Samuel 7, this is a prophecy that's made to David. And God says to David, I will raise up your offspring, which means your seed, to succeed you, and you who will come from your body and will establish his kingdom, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Now, it's that last part. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Tells you he's talking more than just about David's immediate son. No, it's looking down through the centuries to Jesus from the house of David. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Now, let me talk about this for a minute. When you go to the Old Testament, I know you just whiz through this. When you come to Matthew 1, oh, it's a genealogy, begat. Let's move on. Let's get to the good stuff. And you usually skip that stuff. And then you get to Luke, and Luke's a little different. He waits until the third chapter to do that to you. But it's very important that you understand something about that genealogy. Matthew's genealogy is about Jesus' legal line traced from Joseph through David to Abraham. The very first verse starts this way in Matthew 1. Here's the record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And Matthew's whole intent is to make sure that whoever reads this knows that Jesus is the legitimate heir to the kingdom, to the throne. He is the one whose throne will be forever. So that's what Matthew's about. Now, Luke's a little different. And he waits until the third chapter, actually the 23rd verse, to start all the begats. But he says that Jesus' physical line, this is the way he does it, is traced from Matthew to David to Abraham, ending with Adam. Now, listen to what he says. Now Jesus was the son, so it was thought, of Joseph, the son of, and then he, you know, I'm deleting all the in between, and he comes down to the son of Seth, the son of Adam. Notice he doesn't even mention Cain and Abel. Seth was the son who was born after Cain slew Abel. Seth was the godly line, and the son of Adam, the son of God. Now, here's a key thing. So it was thought. Now, hang in there with me. When Luke's giving this genealogy, he's actually not giving Joseph's line, he's giving Mary's line. He says, so it was thought of Joseph, but actually when we start looking at it, we find out it was Mary's lineage. Why? Because this is the physical part of it. The physical part of it. Matthew wanted to give you the legal line, because if Jesus is the Messiah, he's the king, he's the one that's inheriting all of Israel, then they better be able to show legally that he is descendant of David, and in fact, a descendant of Abraham. But here in Luke, Luke's real effort is to give you the history of Jesus' life and to establish his humanity, and he goes all the way back to Adam. Now, all this is important for us, because later in Galatians 4:4-5, this is what Paul says about Jesus. He says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, not some angel that floats down out of heaven. No, born of a woman to redeem those under the law. He actually says, born of a woman, born of the law, under the law, to redeem those under the law, that you and I might receive full rights as sons. What he's telling you there is that God, first of all, promised us a Savior. And it wouldn't be some wishy-washy, angelic, ethereal type thing. No, it would be a genuine human being who would go to the cross and die for our sins. But, well, wait a minute. If it's a human being, well, humans are sinful. How can he die for it? This is the mystery of the scriptures. That in Jesus Christ, he is both God and man. And if you think the Trinity is hard to explain, try that one. But it's the truth. Jesus Christ was God always, but he refused to exercise all the prerogatives he had of his deity in order to come and be our sacrifice. I'll talk about it in a minute, to take our place on the cross. It's his humanity. We have a Savior who died in our place. Well, there was a solution. You say, oh, wow, that last part just really... Okay. I put the scriptures down there for you so you can look at them. But just, I want you to keep in mind here. The beginning of this prophecy started clear back in Genesis. Her seed through Abraham's seed, through David's seed, all the way up to the New Testament to Mary, who gave birth to Jesus. Now, there's a solution to all of this. And it's there even in that third chapter, because you usually miss this part. Then the Lord, after he's kicked them out of the garden, and after he's judged them, he says, he made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. All right, we read that. Well, they were naked, you know, and now they're ashamed of being naked, so isn't that nice? God gave them some clothes. That's not what's going on here, folks. Yeah, they are clothed. But the word clothed there literally means the idea of covering. The Hebrew word meant to cover one's shame, to cover one's nakedness. He's covering them. Well, what is he covering? Not just their nakedness. Follow this for a minute. In the temple, the Ark of the Covenant, that seat that was over the top that the high priest would go in once a year and make atonement for the people, and he'd apply the blood to the mercy seat. They called it the atonement cover, and it represented covering the sins of Israel. Covered them. What was going on there? Where did these skins come from? Oh, the Lord just come, bam, they might want some clothes, let's give it to them. No, that's not what happened. There was a sacrifice. There was a sacrifice of an animal, of a lamb, that he might cover their sins. And over again in Scripture, without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. Now that began in the Old Testament, and it was meant to picture what would ultimately have to happen for you and for me. Without the shedding of the blood of Lamb that takes away the sin of the world, you and I would not have forgiveness. I can't have forgiveness on my own merit. Anybody here could be good enough to merit the forgiveness of God? I don't think so. But Christ did it for me, and he covered my sins. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, 1 John 1:7, cleanses us from all sin. I hope today you can say, I believe that Jesus died for my sins, and he, God, has covered your sins. Well, how did he do that? Well, it was a sacrifice. We read this a little while ago, I think. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, Isaiah 53. Incidentally, this is an amazing passage in the Old Testament. Isaiah 53 is oftentimes called the guilty conscience of the synagogue. Have you heard that before? Because it's tough to explain. Now, most of the rabbis will tell you today, oh, well, it's talking about Israel. Israel's the one that suffered. Oh, yeah? Then why is it that he was pierced for our transgressions? If the hour is Israel, then who is the he? No, no. The earliest rabbis all understood this as pointing to the Messiah. He was pierced for our transgressions. All we like sheep have gone astray, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That's the sacrifice. There on the cross, Jesus bore my sins, your sins, paid for what you and I could never hope to pay for. It's a great example of this prophetically in the New Testament. Before Jesus went to the cross, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Sanhedrin, that whole council, they didn't know what to do with Jesus. And some of the priests were saying, we got to do something because all the people are starting to follow him. What are we going to do? And Caiaphas says, who was the high priest that year, he says, hey, listen, it's better for you that one man die for the people. He already talked about us, and the rest of them said, we can't kill him because then everybody's going to rise up against us. They'll all be mad at us. And he says, it's better that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish. He did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation. So there was a prophecy, a promise of sacrifice that was going to take place. It's all pictured in the Old Testament when they would take a lamb and for Passover, or they would take a ram and slay it during Yom Kippur. No, There is a promise as well as sacrifice of surrender. The surrender is on the part of Jesus. We know this verse, Philippians 2:8. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Hebrews 5:7 says an interesting thing, kind of gives us a glimpse of where Jesus was at. He offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears. You know, we always think of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane and when he prayed. And, oh, Lord, you know, if it be possible, remove this cup from me, but not my will, but your will be done. And we think of Jesus praying that and somewhat calmly. But Hebrews says, with tears and loud cries, I can imagine what he was crying out to the Father as he shrank from having to bear the sins of the world. It wasn't the pain of the cross that Jesus was revulsed by. It was the idea of being smeared with all of your sin and mine. That's pretty ugly. And with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his what? Reverent submission. In John 10, Jesus said, I lay down my life only to take it up again. But no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. There is a promise of surrender. He went to the cross willingly for you and for me. And you know, here's the amazing thing. Okay, 2,000 years ago that he went to the cross. With God, it's timeless. Because he already knew you. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, this is love, not that we love God, but he loved us and gave his life for us. He gave it his life for us. He died even while we were yet sinners. Well, I wasn't born yet. No, but in the mind of God, he knew you and he knew me. He knew what I was going to do. And yet he died for me anyway. That's what took place. He laid it down of his own accord. And therefore, the Hebrew writer says, let's fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. There it is. It wasn't so much the pain, it was the shame of bearing our sins. He went willingly. Well, there's another promise. Promise of salvation. And we're almost done here. This is the best part. Come to the end of the Bible and you get to the book of Revelation 22. And John has that vision of heaven. He says, then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. I can't imagine how spectacular this is going to be when we see this. But the next part, he says, on each side of that river stood the tree of life. There wasn't just one tree of life. There was a tree on both sides. So I guess you can either be a Democrat or a Republican. It doesn't matter in heaven. I don't know if you're in the middle of the road. You're in the middle of the river. I don't know. But the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. There it is, the tree of life. What was lost in the garden? The tree of life. What was man expelled from the garden so they wouldn't be able to access the tree of life? Because had he been able to access the tree of life, he would have been confirmed in his sinfulness. But now, when God has restored everything and you and I are there, the tree of life is there for us. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. He's going to be there with us, and we'll see his face, and his name will be on our foreheads. We're all worried about the Antichrist and worried about the 666 and worried about what's going to be on our... I'm not worried about that. This is what I'm looking forward to. The Lord knows his own, and you and I, one day we accept Jesus Christ, are sealed to the day of redemption. And then afterwards, he knows on our foreheads is his name. And they will reign forever and ever. Blessed are those who wash their robes that they may have the right to the what? Tree of life. And go through the gates in the city. Do you get this? There's a theme. It's that scarlet thread of redemption. It runs through the whole Bible and it ties it together. I always like it. There's an old story about an old preacher who was particularly good. And one young man was asking him one day, you know, what's the key to your preaching? He says, well, first I tell them what I was going to tell them, then I tell them, and then I tell them what I told them. It doesn't get any better than that. That's what the Bible is about. First he tells them what he's going to tell them. I'm putting enmity between your seed and her seed. Yes, you will bruise him on the heel, but he's going to crush your head, Satan. And in between, he tells them how it all unpacks. And then at the end, he tells you, guess what heaven is? It's a tree of life. It's God being in the garden with you. It's everything new. It's everything that was bad. It's gone. Oh, that will be glory for me. When by his grace I will look in his face, that will be glory for me. Yes, indeed. You know, the best part is that never again will God have to say, where are you? Where are you? Hope he doesn't have to say that to us too much. Sometimes he does. Sometimes I'm sure during this whole coronavirus thing, we've had our moments when we just hung our head and we didn't know where he was. And he's saying, where are you? I'm here. Where are you? That's our salvation. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. Then the best part of the thing is it ends with security. We all want security, don't we? Well, the best security is this one. Jesus said, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will ever snatch them out of my hand. He says, my sheep hear my voice. I call them and they answer me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. Nobody can take them out of my hands. And then he says this, my Father has given them to me and no one can take them out of my Father's hands. Boy, you're in good hands when you're in Jesus' hands, because Jesus is in the Father's hands. And I don't know about you, but that's the grip of heaven I want to have in my life, don't you? Amen. Absolutely. And that's why when we come to Romans 8:39, oh, we'd be thrilled when Paul says, nothing will ever separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus, our Lord. I hope you can say that today. I hope that can mean all the world to you today. How can I have this true for me? Maybe you're saying, Mike, well, Jesus said, if you call upon me, I'll answer you. I'll never turn you away. Bible says, call upon the name of the Lord. You'll be saved. You'll be redeemed. You'll be renewed. You'll be a new person. And you'll have security. You have something to look forward to. You know, I say this to our people here, and that's the one thing about preaching in a church like this. We don't all have all the time in the world, do we? It's one thing when I'm talking to somebody, it's, you know, they're just starting their family and stuff, and even then you don't know. But definitely in a congregation like this, and I'm talking to myself, folks, we don't have all the time in the world. Am I ready? Am I ready to go home? Am I ready to be able to hear the Lord say, not where are you, but, oh, there you are, Mike. I'm so good to see you. That's going to be wonderful. I hope it will be for you. You know, what it takes is simply bowing your head. Let's all bow right now this morning. All it takes is with the eyes of your heart looking to God and saying, Lord, I want to be in your hands. Yes, Lord, I want to go to heaven. That's legitimate. But more than that, I want to be in your hands. And I want you to be here in my life right now. Lord, I don't understand everything. I'm not a theologian. But Lord, I come to you today and I do believe that I'm a sinful person. I am what you call me, a sinner. And I know that that separates me from you. It creates a gulf between God and me that I could never hope to hurdle. But you sent Jesus to bridge the gulf. You sent your Son into this world to die on a cross so that my sins would be paid for. I believe that when Jesus said it's finished, that had to do with me. But how happy I am that 3 days later the proof was in the pudding. The proof was in his resurrection. That death and judgment has no grip on me anymore. Lord, we've been put in your hands and your Father is holding on to us. Thank you. I want to believe that today, and I ask you to come into my life and take a hold of it. My friend, if you do that this morning, I can promise you on the authority of God's word, he will come. He will come. Jesus said, I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone hears my voice and answers the door, I will come and I will come in and I will sup with them. I will dine with them and they with me. Lord, that's just the beginning of the taste of heaven. What heaven's all about is what you wanted in the beginning for your creation and for each one of us. Thank you for sending us the answer. Thank you for giving us all the promises. Thank you for a scarlet thread that runs through Scripture. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, a long time ago, I read a story of a wife who wanted to give her husband a special birthday gift. And so she was a little creative, and so she kept putting these boxes in the house. And when he'd open a box, there'd be a little message in it, and it would tell him where to go. And then he'd find another box. And inside that was another little message. Well, this went on and on for about 5 or 6 times. Finally, he got to the last box, and it was a little one. And he opened it up, and inside was one more little note. It's just, I just wanted you to know, I wanted you to look for and discover, I love you forever. You know, that's what the Bible is. It's God's message just to you. That's what prophecy is. It's God constantly unpacking a new gift and helping us understand he loves us with an everlasting love. And we love him. So I'm going to invite you now this morning and stand with me. We're going to sing together. Father, I adore you. Jesus, I adore you. Spirit, I adore you. I hope this morning you can adore him with all of your heart. Because I'll tell you what. He's adored you. He's loved you from eternity. And he wants to love you into eternity. Let's sing together. Mike here, there we go. It's so good to have you all here today. I can't tell you how it thrills my heart. And I want to wish a happy Father's Day to everybody. And I'm going to ask Elise Bedford, she's the chairman of our women's ministry. She's going to close in prayer, but she's also going to tell you about a special little gift that the ladies want to give to our guys.
You stole my thunder. Not really. But I am so delighted to see all of you here. Please sit down. It is so different, but also so normal to see all of you. And I'm delighted on behalf of the women's ministry to wish all of the men in our group a happy Father's Day. And we would like to honor all of the men of the church, but all of the men anyway, for your presence and what you do for the women of the church. And a tasty reminder of the fact that God created all of you to be fishers of men. You may not have thought about that, but We did. And I would like for you to receive a little gift that will remind you of that. So when you walk out the doors, the women of the church will give you your gift, and be sure to take it. So now let's pray to our Heavenly Father. Thank you, dear Father, that you are able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to your power that is at work within us. To you be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. And Father, we trust that this morning will have been a worship full of sweet aroma for you. And now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.